Welcome to Crossroad Connection, speaking out for those left unheard. My name is David Scheringa, and I'm the host of your program, the president of Crossroad Bible Institute. I don't know if you've thought much about the idea of friendship in prison, but that's going to be our topic today here on Letters from Prison. And to help me with this special edition of Letters from Prison is Aaron Zoudendam. Is that correct?
Yes.
Okay. Well, welcome.
Thank you.
Glad to have you here. And let's talk about friendship before we jump into these letters just a little bit.
Okay.
Do you have any friends?
A few. Yeah.
You have a few. Okay. And what does a friend mean to you?
Wow, that's a good and difficult question. Well, I think almost anyone would agree that life can be, there are times when it's, you know, easier and times when it's harder. And I think we value friends, particularly when things are difficult, and they help us remember the blessings that we do have with their support and their love for us.
So friends for you, it's more than just, you know, someone to hang out with, but it provides support. And in difficult times, a friend is going to be there for you, huh?
Right.
And then it means all the more. Now, what about Facebook friends? Do they count?
Well, you can count them. Facebook will tell you how many friends you have, but sometimes in the thousands.
I mean, call me a grouch, but hasn't Facebook friends really demeaned the meaning of friendship?
I like how you can friend someone, how that's a verb now. I'm going to friend you.
And you can unfriend
me. Right. You're going to unfriend someone.
Yeah. So it just seems to me that friendship today doesn't have that deep meaning. You know, when a person says, well, I have 300 close friends, you know. But we all do know that to have a real friend besides us, to be with us, to help us, can mean all the difference in the world. And so you brought some letters today.
Yes.
About friendship and people in prison.
Mm-hmm. Right.
Why don't you get us started here? Tell us more, and
sure.
Let's get started.
This is from John, and he's incarcerated in Louisiana. And he wrote to us, I am writing this letter, first of all, to say thank you for your ministry. I am a new Christian at 55 years old, and I'm trying my very best at these studies. Jail is full of some of the worst sin there is, and I wouldn't wish it on anyone. I feel what Paul felt, rejected and lonely, but I believe God alone gives me hope. No one out there writes me except maybe a couple of Christians whom I don't really know as well as you guys at CBI. Your letters are so well appreciated because I have no family, no friends out there. It's just basically me and God now.
And where was he from?
Louisiana.
Louisiana, mm-hmm. Which is amazing because he actually has actual friends who are writing him and so forth, but he finds the friends at CBI
right.
to be more meaningful.
Right.
People probably don't realize how lonely prison can be, even though you're surrounded by all these people, right?
Yeah. We've all been in situations where we feel really alone, even if we're in a crowd, but for that to be kind of day in and day out is unimaginable for most of us, probably.
And so they start to get these letters from Crossroad Bible Institute
mm-hmm.
and feel that they have a friend.
Yeah.
I want to get back to that, but let's have another letter okay. Before we do that.
This is from Kasai. I think I'm saying that right. He's from Fiji, which is why his name is unfamiliar to us.
And for our viewers, Fiji is an island off of Australia.
In the South Pacific, yeah.
Yes.
And he writes, greetings in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ from all your brothers in Christ here at the minimum security prison in Fiji. I wish to acknowledge your ministry's commitment to this program and to all inmates over here. My inmate friend who introduced me to this program was discharged last week. It's my prayer that God's blessings will go with him. Please pray for me that I remain in God's word, value his word, and meditate on it day and night. God is looking for people who will rebuild walls through intercessory prayer, to stand in the gap, to advocate on behalf of these who are lost. You know, greater love has no man than this, than that he will lay down his life for his friend.
That's a great, great letter. There's like several island nations there, Solomon Islands, Fiji, Vanuatu,
Tonga,
Tonga, and we have students on all those islands, mm-hmm. thanks to the good work of CBI Australia.
Right. Yes.
They're working so hard there. They sound to me almost like penal colonies.
It's strange because I thought of Fiji as a place where you went for a tropical vacation, I think. I think people go there for that.
It does sound it. They probably have that going on too.
But my exposure to it here has been mostly people who are, you know, obviously in prison there, and it doesn't sound so great now. So.
Right, right. And also, I believe that in a number of those island nations, you know, even like Papua New Guinea, not far away, Crossroad is, if not the only religious program, certainly the most revered and respected. So they I think they understand that personal character of it, which is the letters.
Right, right.
And so some real mentoring can take place. Mm-hmm. Some real friendships can be established.
Yeah.
He lost a friend who told him about CBI, right?
Right, right. That must be really difficult. We know in the United States, people get transferred a lot, and there's nothing
True.
You could do if you had perhaps met a kindred spirit and he or she got transferred. There would be you can't correspond from one prisoner to another. I'm pretty sure that's illegal.
Yes, it is. It is illegal in this country.
It would be heartbreaking. Because
sometimes prisoners have asked, after they finished our program, if they could become instructors. But most DOCs frown on prisoner-to-prisoner communication.
Oh, yeah.
So, you know, that's just not possible. Well, after the break, I want to talk a little bit more about friendships in prison and the limitations that are on that. And we're going to get more of these great letters. We'll be right back after this.
At Crossroad Bible Institute, we are committed to helping people in prison develop relationships with Jesus Christ. By correcting Bible study lessons and writing letters of encouragement, CBI instructors participate in this ministry in a safe and secure way. For more information or to sign up to become a CBI instructor, please visit us at cbi.fm on the web.
Welcome back to Crossroad Connection. My name is David Schuringa. I'm the host of the program. And today on the program, Letters from Prison, we're learning about friendship in prison. Now, if you think about it, Aaron, that's got to be not an easy matter because, well, life is rough in prison. And who do you trust? And
sure.
who do you confide in?
Mm-hmm.
What does that all mean? It seems to me that would be more difficult on the inside than the outside, you know,
yeah,
because you could have trouble with a friend, but you still got to deal with them.
Right, right. Or I think if I went to prison, I maybe wouldn't find a lot of kindred spirits there, you know.
Mm-hmm.
You don't have any choice like here in, you know, out in society. I could go to church and look for friends there. I could join an interest group and look for friends there. I have my family, all kinds of built-in structures for making friends.
Right. Something I came across just the other day, and we're gonna start doing some shows on solitary confinement and the impact that that has. And so I want our viewers to be looking for that and be reading about it. But a friend of mine sent me an article on solitary confinement that was in the New York Times, and I'm sure we'll refer to that article in the book that it refers to. And it's very interesting that my friend, who's a fellow pastor, he was reminded of the text, "It's not good for man to be alone."
Sure.
Which is very, very apropos to our topic today.
Yeah.
And then if you think about solitary confinement, which cuts you off from your friends.
Mm-hmm.
And according to this article, and I'm just going to whet the appetite of our viewing audience a little bit. Solitary confinement does more damage to a person than flogging.
Sure.
Emotional.
Lasting damage.
Lasting damage.
Mm-hmm.
So we were designed as social persons.
Yeah.
And social, we need that. And it's strange. We had this past winter, we had two deer die in our backyard. We live out in the country.
Oh, no.
And it was a long, long winter. And so a lot of deer did not get enough to eat, okay?
Mm-hmm.
And the interesting thing about deer, we learned that they are a social animal. And when one deer gets sick, other deer will come to visit it.
How sweet.
While it's sick. And then there's more. When the deer dies for several days, other deer will come and pay their last respects.
That's really sweet.
It's like, I don't think all animals do that, but I heard elephants do, I guess.
Okay.
But so how much more than we as God's image bearers, mm-hmm. you know, you think about the Trinity. Yeah. God is in a relationship with himself. And so we need friends for getting through life, for enjoying life, yeah. for maintaining our sanity, yeah. right?
There's a strain of that even outside of Christianity. The Greeks believed that and said, I think it's man by nature desires to live in a polis or in society. And it was kind of their fundamental understanding of what separates humans from animals.
So it's something that you know from such special grace in the Bible, but also from common grace,
right.
common sense, and even to an extent the animal kingdom has needs for friends.
Right.
Let's have another letter.
Okay. This is from Shannon in Illinois, and I actually have read quite a bit by him, and he has an extraordinary story, but he wrote to us, "As I started the curriculum, my knowledge and understanding of the word increased significantly. This helped me to count my current trials and tribulations as a time of joy and the opportunity for the testing of my faith. I also appreciated my instructor's personal stories of loss and challenges, which elevated the letters to the level of a dear friend. Most importantly, I look forward to mail call daily with the anticipation of receiving some correspondence from CBI."
Wow. Mm-hmm. So we're not talking about just casual little notes, attaboy, but right. there's solid correspondence of friendships, mm-hmm. and friendships can be maintained wonderfully through mail.
Oh, sure.
And in fact, sometimes even better than face-to-face because you have to sit down and take time and actually write to them. But
sure.
I've heard so many cases where they just felt that their instructor, this student, has become a friend and a confidant and someone mm-hmm. that they can talk to and get advice. Very interesting that every day, looking in the mail for a CBI thing, 80% of people in prison, we are told, receive no mail.
Oh, that's heartbreaking.
And also we have heard that there are many who have begun our program when they heard that there were personal letters involved.
That's what drew them in. Huh? That's what drew them in.
That was the worm on the hook.
Sure.
You know, and we're okay with that.
Oh, certainly.
Yes. Because we have heard, you know, sometimes it's embarrassing that day after day after day, your name is never called for mail.
Oh, that's heartbreaking.
You know, it's heartbreaking. But this can change all that. And that's what I wanted to talk about before the break. And that is, a lot of times people don't understand the letter part. They don't get that, you know. But a Bible study, and there's other Bible studies, that just throws Bible studies at to fill out. That's just not what's needed, you know, just to drop off Bibles and Bible studies. It needs to be personalized. These letters, I believe, are the Word become flesh.
Sure.
You know, Jesus, he assumed human flesh and he dwelt among us and he became our friend. That's what the letters do. That's the difference that they make. And that's why the program is so powerful. Huh?
Oh, sure.
Before we go to the break, let's have one more letter.
Okay. This is from Harold, and he is incarcerated in California. He says, "I was baptized on August 9th, 2012. I finally took the real step in my journey, and I feel really good about it. CBI helped me to do all this, and without CBI, I don't know what I'd be doing right now. CBI has given me what I could not give myself, courage. Thank you, CBI, for being my friend and helping me out. Please keep the lessons coming."
What does that mean, courage?
I was thinking as I was reading it that ideally we all wish that we had friends who would make us better people and not worse people. I think everyone's maybe seen that happen or experienced it. And I love that to him, CBI gave him the courage to go ahead and get baptized and kind of take what he calls that.
I don't know why I have in my mind a picture of the cowardly lion on the Wizard of Oz. And when he met Dorothy and the other three friends, he got courage. without even knowing it. So
yeah.
I guess good friends help make you more courageous, because a friend says, you can do it,
right,
you can do
right.
it. And that's what keeps them in the program, too, mm-hmm. in the CBI lessons. You can do it. You can do it. Keep
right.
it up. Keep it up. We need that kind of encouragement in life.
Yeah.
Otherwise, it's so easy to give up.
Sure.
And so we can be an encouragement to friends, and we can receive encouragement from our friends, right?
Right. Yeah.
Hey, before we continue on, I want to talk to our viewers a minute about a book that I want to send you. And this is my latest book, 7 Secrets for Success in the Workplace. Have you read this yet, Erin?
I think that I have read it all, although usually I'm kind of skimming through looking for one thing, but I think I've pretty much hit all of it. Yeah.
A good answer. Okay. I'm glad you read my book, but you sounded a bit ambivalent in your answer. But but is it a good book?
Indeed.
Indeed.
Yeah.
7 Secrets for Success in the Workplace. I wrote this for our students, but everybody's buying it, because a lot of kids today, a lot of people today, don't know how to work. They don't understand the keys for success for work. So they continue on with the lowest paying jobs, working for minimum wage, never rise up. 7 Secrets for Success, it actually is about the Christian work ethic. And it's available online, and you can buy it. But guess what? We got a special offer today. I'm going to give away 10 free copies to the first 10 people that contact us. You can email us. You can email me, david@cbi.tv. It's right there on your screen, david@cbi.tv, and say, I'm writing for the free book that we will send you. And so maybe you have a son or a daughter or a friend that needs to do better and doesn't know the secrets for success. You know, Erin, sometimes people think that if I show up to work on time most of the time, I'm okay. But the fact is, people who succeed are always on time.
Sure.
Not just most of the time, right?
Yeah.
One of the secrets that I have here is that to always be positive. You know, people don't like to be around negative people.
Sure.
Right? And so we should be positive thinkers, people that are can-do kind of people. And positive people don't sit in a rut in the workplace. They
sure.
keep moving up.
Mm-hmm.
And I talk about the importance of getting a mentor.
Which is kind of
like
a friend. Yeah.
It's kind of like a friend,
mm-hmm.
a friend who's a few steps ahead
right.
of you. And so here's the book, 7 Secrets for Success in the Workplace. I want you to have a copy, so write us today. Let's get back to talking about these friends. And let's kick it off with another letter.
Okay. This is from Ruth Ann, and she is incarcerated in Michigan. And she writes, I feel like I accomplished just one more step in getting closer to God, understanding his word. I also feel almost a sense of comfort, like I have a friend who really cares. Being in prison is so hard some days, but I look forward to my Crossroad lessons.
That's someone in Michigan,
mm-hmm.
A female student.
Yes.
And we have lots of female students, but not nearly as many as male students, because
right.
I think 90% of people incarcerated are male. Mm-hmm. No, 95%.
Okay.
But about 10% rather than 5% of our students are female.
That's great.
And so she finds the whole friendship aspect and that support is something that's very strong.
Yeah.
It's a friend will give of themselves for someone, right?
Mm-hmm.
How many friends can a person really have?
I've heard it gets fewer as you get older. So I've heard that when
why? Because you get grumpier or you trust less people or what?
I don't know, but I've heard that they've done studies, and the number of people that you can really have a very close relationship with just gets kind of smaller and smaller as you age. So, and that kind of makes sense. When you're in grade school, then you have like 20 friends, you know. Everyone's your friend.
Maybe our definition of friendship and true friendship changes
sure.
as we get older.
Sure.
Is that possible?
As you can support deeper relationships, and that obviously takes more work and more time.
My grandfather, Abe DeVries, who died when I was in third grade, I still hear stories about the legend of Abe DeVries, that he was one of these very wise men in the community. He always be on the church leadership board, and one of these guys that would not say hardly anything the whole meeting after, but then they would discuss an important issue, then they all kind of turned to Abe. Then Abe would say what he thought, and that's the way they would go, you know, because he had just had this this sense of wisdom. But I remember as a kid, my mom telling me that her dad, Abe, had a saying. He says, "You can count your true friends on one hand and have fingers left over." So maybe there is some truth to that. You know, maybe there's friendships at different levels.
Sure.
But maybe that's also why, you know, there's no friend like Jesus. He is our greatest friend. He laid down his life for us.
Right.
He will never let us down. So maybe there are different levels of friendship.
Sure.
As well. But we are delighted that Crossroad Bible Institute can be a form of friendship for those who are friendless.
Right.
And feel extremely alone. I think the Christmas card program that we have, that churches can get involved in stuff like that, also reflects that.
Right.
You got one more there for us?
I do. This is from Jeffrey, also incarcerated in California. And he wrote, "As for Crossroad, it seems I've been with them about 6 or 7 years. Some say that's a long time to be with a correspondence course. But I tell those who respond as such that I love Crossroad. I am encouraged by my instructor to keep up the good work, that I am somebody, and that I can change for the better and for the rest of my life. Now that's encouragement from a friend when I didn't have any friends at all. This I have been thankful for. Today there's a different story, however. Because of all the spiritual heat I've taken great interest in, I now have lots of friends. See how wonderfully God works in our lives."
Whoa, yeah. Oh, that has a surprise ending. Crossroad was his only friend.
Mm-hmm.
And then he discovered more friends out there, Christians. Must be fellow Christians in the prison, or he's just having a positive effect there. What do you think?
Could be either. I remember another testimony I read maybe a couple months ago. I don't remember where I came across it, but someone said that they had been very, I think this gentleman used the word antisocial when he was committing his crimes, and then when he first got to prison, and then he said, "Now I try to show everyone the love that Christ showed to me," which is incredible. It's kind of like, okay, you did it, you got it right, you know, like that's what we all hope for, and it seems like he really found that.
Well, that's very interesting. Now you're bringing up a pretty profound point, because when you talk about Christianity and the body of Christ in Scripture, they talk about that, you know, the ear should not say to the finger, "I don't need you," you know, or the eye shouldn't say to the foot, "I don't need you." But for the body to function, for the work of Christ to be done, it's going to be done in connection with others. And so in that way, friendship is a very profound tool that God uses in order to accomplish his mission. And then we feel fulfilled when we can do that with our friends.
Right.
Here's a figure for you. I don't know if you knew this, but did you know that 35% of our students come to us from recommendations of other students?
That's great.
And you know, they just can't do that out of the blue to somebody. You know, they need to, you know, it's going to be a friend. It's going to be somebody that trusts them. And so there's an example of the body of Christ working together to be united in accomplishing the mission.
Yeah, that's great.
We're going to wrap up this little session on friendship. I think I'm going to probe you a little bit more about friends.
Uh-oh.
So we'll be right back after this message.
Research shows that people in prison who participate in faith-based programs during their incarceration are dramatically less likely to go back to prison after their release. Crossroad Bible Institute provides biblical instruction for tens of thousands of people in prison. You can participate in this ministry by correcting Bible study lessons, donating, and praying for CBI. Go to cbi.fm on the web for more information.
Welcome back to Crossroad Connection. I'm speaking with Aaron Zoudendam about friendship in prison. And you know, you can become a friend of prisoners. There's a safe and secure way to to mentor people mm-hmm. in prison and become their friend, and that's to become a Crossroad instructor.
Right.
And I have seen so many times that how meaningful those relationships are. And we have this set up so that it's safe, it's secure, you can become a mentor, a friend mm-hmm. to a prisoner, and actually learn a lot. It's not a one-way street.
Sure.
People can learn from the people in prison, and it's a two-way street, and it becomes a wonderful friendship. Mm-hmm. As we close here, think in your mind of your closest friend.
Okay.
All right. And tell me what's special about this person.
Does my husband count, or should I choose a different person?
No, your husband counts.
Okay.
My wife's my best friend.
Yeah. Kind of, it works well that way, you know.
Instead of like you having a male friend.
Right.
Yeah.
And I'm, so what's special about that person?
What are the top three qualities of a good friend?
Yeah. It certainly helps to feel that, I think very few things kind of kill a friendship faster than judgment.
Unconditional acceptance.
Right. I think that's really important. I can't imagine feeling as if someone kind of disapproved of me all the time. And
it's very interesting. Very interesting. That's the number one thing we tell our instructors about mm-hmm. becoming instructors is unconditional acceptance.
Right.
Do not judge them. Don't even ask what they've done.
Right.
You just named one reason that make a good friend.
Right.
Give me a second big thing.
Let's see. When my husband and I share, I don't know, I guess the way that we kind of process the world is very similar. So the things that are important to him are really important to me. And that's, again, it works well that way because that means that our resources and our time when we sit down and try to figure out where did those go, you know, we're almost always in concert on that, and that's just really, it's really wonderful.
So friends share their worldviews.
Often, yeah. I mean, you know, I don't think it has to be that way.
And they share their thoughts and what they're thinking about things and talk about life, and that's something to do with these letters.
Yeah.
You have one more?
I think it's always, I guess the French have this concept, and it's called, an ami d'enfance, which is like, it translates to childhood friend, but that's not quite it. And what it is if it's the friend you have probably from childhood, but they would at any moment drop everything and come help you if you needed it. It would just, you could call them up in the middle of the night and they would, you know, jump on a plane and come help you.
So a friend deeply cares about you.
Right.
I was thinking of one as you were talking as well, that friends forgive.
Sure. It's really critical. just crucial.
That's the opposite of judgment, mm-hmm. that friends will overlook shortcomings mm-hmm. and they will forgive. Even if you hurt them, you can work it out, huh?
Mm-hmm. Right.
So friends share their worldview, they share their ideas, they care about each other, they're non-judgmental. But we could write a book on friendship just from their interactions with Crossroad students and instructors.
Sure, yeah.
Do you have anyone else, or is this it?
I have one more,
okay,
and this is from Joel.
Just enough time for that.
This is from Joel in Florida. He writes, I consider the letters just like getting a letter from a friend. I feel like I know the people after I read their letters. It reminds me that not everyone in society has written me off or given up on me. So that's kind of it in a nutshell of what we hope for.
That brings it all together. Yeah. And I just want to thank our audience. Thank you for joining us for this special edition of Crossroad Connection, Friends in Prison and Friendship through Crossroad Bible Instructors. And as I said, you can become a friend of prisoners, and prisoners can become your friends in a safe and secure way. Go to our website, cbi.tv, if you're not there already, and get involved. You can send us money. You can become an instructor. You can provide an enrollment form for someone that you know in prison. You can get your church involved. There's just all kinds of ways to get involved with Crossroad Bible Institute. And remember this, before we leave, that you have a friend in Jesus. My name is David Scheringa. Thank you for joining us. We hope to see you again right here next week.
Live.